there is a creature alive today who has survived millions of years of evolution without change, without passion, and without logic. It lives to kill. A mindless eating machine. It will attack and devour anything. It is as if God created the devil and gave him jaws. From the best-selling novel, Jaws. Rated PG. Maybe too intense for younger children.
Hello and welcome back to a very special summer edition. It's summer of Book Versus Movie. This is a podcast where we read books that have been adapted into movies, and then we try to decide which we like better, the book or the movie. I am Margot P. of the Chingona Homesteader, and this is my good friend and co-host Margot D. of Brooklyn Fit Chick.
Hello, everybody. Happy summer.
So we are, this is a replay. This is a replay, but we thought since we are now kicking off summer, and Memorial Day is now in the rearview mirror, we are officially in summer mode, we thought we would replay one of our favorite episodes. So nice, we did it twice. But before we get to that, we want to remind you, speaking of summer, that later this summer, we're going to be in New Orleans.
Yes, we will. So we're going to be at the Potter and Love Convention, August 10th, 11th, and 12th. That's in New Orleans. You guys, you need to go to pottern.love and use the checkout code BVM. That's for Book Versus Movie, and you get a discount on your tickets. There's over 40 podcasts that are going to be there. Margo and I were looking at the schedule. Some really great people are going to be there. The Gen Y podcast is going to be there. We're going to be there. Unwritable Rant, Twisted Philly. There's some really great shows. So you guys go to pottern.love, and the checkout is BVM for your discount.
And if you can't make it, be sure and join our Facebook group for updates while we are there. We will definitely be updating our experience at Potter and Love on our exclusive Facebook group.
Yeah, so you just go to facebook.com/, you type in Book vs Movie Podcast Group, you ask to join the group, and then you can come and join the fun. We're just a little bit more interactive there. We also do have a basic Facebook page. Please sure to like that page because we post all the episodes there. We're on Twitter at Book vs a Movie. You spell that out. You can send us an email for comments and suggestions. That's bookversusmoviepodcast@gmail.com. And if you like the show, please be sure to subscribe. But if you love the show, yay! If you can leave us a 5-star review, that would be totally amazing. We will read all the 5-star reviews on the air in Apple Podcasts. So please, if you have a moment, if you can do that for us, that would be amazing. And we're also brought to you by Audible. You get your free 30-day trial. You just go to audibletrial.com/book versus movie. And the book Jaws by Peter Benchley is on Audible if you want it.
Don't get it. Just don't get it.
Yeah, teaser of what we're going to talk about.
Get the Great Gatsby. Get the Great Hall. Do not get Jaws.
Yes, get the Great Gatsby.
When you listen to this episode, you will hear why.
Exactly. So, yeah, so we'll be back soon with our full episode. We're going to be talking about Call Me By Your Name next. We're both excited to cover that one. But today, we're going right into dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun. Everybody, here's Jaws.
In 1975, the world's attitude towards some ocean creatures changed radically. That's when a film based on Peter Benchley's novel Jaws tapped into the most primordial of human fears. Before his death, Benchley remembered what inspired him to create one of the screen's most frightening monsters.
The shark was like a maniac to me. It was an unstoppable, uncontrollable force. And that, when I was a child, was always the most scary thing, was the maniac, the guy with the axe who you couldn't stop.
Peter Benchley has spent years now trying to establish a counterpoint to the myth that sharks are really out to get us. Made a good story, but that's all it was a good story.
If there's one thing I know for dead certain, it's that I couldn't possibly write Jaws today. I could not turn this beautiful beast into a villain.
There is a creature alive today who has survived millions of years of evolution without change, without passion, and without logic. It lives to kill. A mindless eating machine. It will attack and devour anything. It is as if God created the devil and gave him jaws. Roy Scheider, Robert Shaw, Richard Dreyfus.
You're going to need a bigger boat.
From the best-selling novel, Jaws, rated PG, maybe too intense for younger children.
Done it. Done it, done it, done it, done it. Hello! I haven't sung in the beginning in so long. That was me singing, by the way. This is Book Versus Movie, the podcast where we read books that have been adapted into movies, and then my friend and I try and decide which we like better, the book or the movie. I am Margot P. of Nacho Mama's blog, and on the line I have my good friend and co-host, Margot D. of Brooklyn Fit Chick.
Hi, everyone. It's the end of summer, so we wanted to give one more summer shout-out with this book today. And we covered this, Margot, a couple of years ago, but it was the old way we used to record things, so we wanted to just kind of toss that out and dive right in again. And it was so much fun to do.
It was, and we've had a few people ask if we could do this. I guess they hadn't heard the original one that we did. So yeah, we're going to give it another. We're going to go back in the water.
Yes,
as they say. So yeah, this is Book Versus Movie, and something I realized because before we read the book and watched the movie this time, we re-listened to the old episode, or at least I did. I think you did too.
Yeah.
And I realized something we have not mentioned lately because we just assume everybody knows this, which is that one. You and I are not scholars of books or films.
No, we're not.
We're friends who like to read and watch movies. And two, in the course of our discussion, we spoil everything.
Right. Right.
Well, so just a blanket spoiler alert. If you've not read the book or watched the movie, I can't imagine why you'd be listening to this if you've never seen Jaws, but maybe you haven't. We're going to spoil it all.
And
you
and Margo, I was on a business trip this week out west, not where you are, but north of you. And on my JetBlue flight, Jaws was like one of the free movies you can watch. And yes, I watched it both ways.
Oh, that's so great. We are part of the Electronic Media Collective.
Yes, we certainly are. And if you like what you hear, the way you find Book Versus Movie, wherever you get your podcast, whatever app you use to find your podcast, you type in Book VS Movie Podcast. And that's how you'll find us. Because when we started the show a few years ago, it's been like 3 or 4 years now, Margo. I mean, we've been doing this forever. But when we started, we didn't know what we were doing. So like we have this RSS feed we can't lose. So it's Book VS Movie if you're searching for us. If you like what you hear, please subscribe. That way you'll never miss an episode. And if you love what you hear, yay, leave a review, and especially a 5-star review. If you leave us a 5-star review, and we can use some more reviews lately, they've been kind of slow lately, we will read them on the air, and we will be so grateful to you guys. And you can find us on social media. On Facebook and Twitter, you spell out Book Versus and Movie. And if you want to send us an email, we love emails. It's bookversusmoviepodcast@gmail.com.
That's right. And we have an Audible affiliation.
And we certainly do, Margo. So for you listeners of Book Versus Movie, Audible is offering a free audiobook download with a free 30-day trial to give you the opportunity to check out their service. And I want to recommend this because we're actually going to play a snippet. We've never done this before. We're going to play a snippet of the audiobook for Jaws. And it's read... And by the way, I'm going to spoil right now. Margo and I, whenever we put our things, what's better, the book or the movie? A lot of people just immediately tweet back or whatever. Duh, it's the book. We're going to make a pretty damn good case against that today. But it is read by Eric Steele, who does a fine job with the material he's given.
Yes. Yes. I can say it. That is true.
Yes.
That is true. But did you already give the link about getting a free book?
Oh, yes. Let me say that again. Yes. So that was my recommendation for you guys. So to download your free audiobook today, go to audibletrial.com/book-versus-movie. Again, that's audibletrial.com/book-versus-movie. And basically, you guys, you create like this cloud account with these books. So you could put it on your iPod or whatever. And if you need to free up space, you can delete it, but you can always go back to it if you want to. So it's a really great service. And if you don't like your book, they will let you exchange it for another one. So Margo and I, people always say, how do you guys, you know, read all these books? We listen to an awful lot of them. That's how we were able to do the show. So, yeah.
I think the first time that we did Jaws, I think I got the audiobook. This time I got a first edition of the hard copy book. But again, in the spoiler alert, spoiler alert, don't get the book Jaws on Audible. Just don't. Please.
There's so many other ones. There's thousands of other books there.
It's so much worse out loud than it is on the page.
We'll give you guys a little snippet later when we get into more of the book itself. But should we dive into Peter Benchley first, Margo?
Yes. Yeah. Who is a very interesting guy.
Super interesting. So Peter Benchley, born May 8th, 1940 in New York City, and he comes from a family of literary people. His father was a writer. He's the grandson of Robert Benchley, who was founder of the Algonquin Roundtable. And if you don't know what that is, Google it. It's very important. He graduated from Harvard in 1961, and he wrote a nonfiction travel book, Time and a Ticket. And then in 64, he became a reporter for Washington Post. He was a television reporter for Newsweek in the 60s. And then in 1967, he was a speechwriter for LBJ, and he's married to Wendy in 1964. And I'm going to put a picture on one of the tweets when I, you know, broadcast the tweets. He and Wendy are like the cutest couple of all time. I just think they're adorable. And they had three kids. And in 1971, he was obsessed with sharks all of his life. He grew up, he spent his summers near Nantucket, and he was working freelancing and struggling to support his three kids and his wife. And he had two ideas he wanted to do, two for novels. One was about a pirate and one was about a man-eating shark. And basically, he was able to sell the shark idea. And at the time, he got a whopping $1,000 advance to write the book. And that's about $6,000 in today's dollar. But if you're going to write a book, you know, as many people know, it's going to take several months. So he was really, it was a big risk he was going to take.
But also it was his first book. I mean, it is not a lot of money now that we know it's Jaws, but considering he was a kid, basically, and an unknown and inexperienced writer, that's pretty impressive.
And he really stuck with it. I mean, he was a very active freelance writer. But he was at this point, he's like, I think he was like 30 or 31. He's like, I'm going to give this one more year and then I'll go back to editing or something. And so it becomes this big success. So as you know, and my mother stayed with me 2 weeks ago when I was talking about this episode, and she goes, oh God, I remember that book. It was terrible. But everybody liked this book. And she said, you went to the beach. You know, I grew up on Long Island. She's like, everybody at the beach had this damn book. And it was the bestseller list for 44 weeks on the New York Times bestseller list. I mean, it's incredible. And it sold 20 million copies. And you have one of them, Margo.
I do. I do. And we were talking, I think the first time around, we read the 30th anniversary edition of Jaws. And by the way, all the not very nice things that we're about to say about the book, the author has himself said pretty much.
Yes.
He knows it's not like a masterpiece of literature. And so, yeah, again, spoiler alert, this book stinks on ice. There's my blurb for the back cover. It's really bad. But one of the things is we were talking about the title Jaws was not his first choice at all. He had like a zillion other titles that he had considered when, of course, obviously Jaws is the best title of all.
Absolutely.
And if you're on our Facebook page, I put a photograph of the first edition copy of the book that I got to read this time. I forget, what year is it? 1974
it came out.
74. And the cover looks a lot like we remember the iconic poster of the woman swimming on the surface of the water and the great big shark about to come up and eat her, except in the first edition of the book, the background is black. And the publishers felt that the image of the shark, the great white shark with all those teeth coming up to devour the woman, was suggestive of a vagina dentata. There's another thing for you to Google.
Another thing to Google, yes.
So they said, you know what? Okay, we love the cover, but let's lose the teeth. So instead of looking like a giant man-eating vagina about to eat the woman, she's instead about to be devoured by what?
A penis.
a penis, a giant penis.
It looks like emerging from the water for some reason in salt water. I mean, it's just absurd. It's so crazy bad. It's so bad because it's terrible.
You can't look at it and not think of a penis. I'm sorry, you cannot.
We dare you.
We dare you. In fact, when I was reading it, because I was, you know, I was taking it around with me and I was reading it like in Starbucks and stuff, I was embarrassed to have the cover face up. It's that suggestive.
It's pretty ridiculous.
It's pretty silly. Eventually, in later editions, they use the same image that they use in the movie. But that's just one example of how, like, just... I don't understand why it was such a big hit, except that the movie was a hit.
I was thinking also, Margot, I mean, it was, you know, the time that it was, and this is something my mom and I were talking about. She goes, like, look, we didn't have cable TV then. You know, you had a few channels and TV wasn't that good back then. And so a lot of people would just read to relax on the evenings and weekends. So it was a pop boiler. I've read plenty of crappy books, you know, that are pop boilers that are just plot driven too. And, you know, it doesn't take up too much of your time. I mean, nowadays TV's so great that it competes with that. But I think it was also he was so inspired. So the thing about Peter Benchley, like, his first draft wasn't very good for his publisher, so they decided they were inspired by The Godfather, which came out a few years before.
Yes, which was a wild hit at the time.
And you and I should probably redo that episode one day, The Godfather.
Yeah,
episode.
Because I remember I was so ill when we did that.
We were both sick.
The Godfather by Mario Puzo was a mega monster publishing hit and also a hit movie. And so people are like, oh, well, let's have some gangsters in there.
Yes, and sex.
And more sex. And we should say, though, The Godfather, though, is a great book and a very fun read.
Yeah.
But there's this tacked on mobster subplot.
So yes, it's just
such a mess.
It's so silly. So it's Amity Island, and it's hinted about in the movie, and we'll get into more in the movie. But just like everyone is freaked out that these people depend on business in the summer. If they don't make money in the summer, they can't even lose a weekend, or they literally, as it says in the book, they will be on welfare the rest of the year.
Yeah.
So
it's true.
And it's true. And so the mob bought up all these properties on the island. So the mob wants to make sure that people are on the beach. And it's even like you and I were discussing that, just flashing back in my head, like every character in this book is really obnoxious. Like there's nobody you root for.
True. There is not one likable human in the entire book. Every single character. You have no stake in any of it. You're just like, I just don't care about a single one of these people.
Yeah, we have
not one.
We have all of them there. We have like Hooper and we have Brody and we have Ellen. But in the movie, like it's so. So in the book, the husband and wife, Brody and his wife, don't get along. And that she was like a hoity-toity society girl, Long Island rich girl. And she basically married down to be married to him. And then Hooper is the younger brother of a guy she dated when she was either in high school or college. I can't remember which one. But Hooper shows up and he's an obnoxious asshole. Like, just as soon as he shows up, he's a rich kid and treats everybody with contempt. It's the mayor is a schmuck. There's a reporter that's always trying to, you know, trying to figure out the news that's there. I remember there's one scene where they did close the beach down, and it takes place in Long Island in the book. And there's a person that drove from Queens to come to the beach to actually watch the sharks. And they're like, he's like yelling like, hey, how come this beach isn't open? They're like, because somebody was killed here yesterday. And he was even hyper aggressive and obnoxious. Like he brought his children to see a killer shark. It's just,
the Godfather is actually a good kind of comparison. Mm-hmm. The Godfather is about criminals. And yet, as you're reading the story about people who are breaking the law and killing people left, right, and center, like you get really invested in these characters. And I don't know if you're like rooting for them to succeed in their crimes or anything, but you do kind of you get attached to them. That happens not at all in this book whatsoever. In Jaws,
it's ridiculous.
They're all just, the marriage is a crappy marriage. Like, why are you guys married to each other? Ew. And I mean, the kids are obnoxious. I feel sorry for the woman whose little boy gets killed.
That's it. And then like there's a scene where I remember this, and there's a scene where there's what the mobster goes to somebody's front yard and then picks up a cat from the lawn and then kills the cat. It's like
the kid in front of his kid.
For the kid. And it's like, what? And then I want to play you guys. See, so there's this part in the book. Okay, here's another subplot that's like completely ridiculous. And by the way,
it's so bad.
It's so bad. Steven Spielberg said himself the first time he read the novel, I was rooting for the shark. Like, yeah. he hated all his characters. So there's a whole subplot that Hooper and Ellen have a romance. And there's a big, dumb scene where they're having lunch in the middle of the day, and they're having this, like, racy conversation, and they start to talk about their fantasies. And her fantasy is being raped. And it is awful to read.
She's talking about, like, oh, you know, I have just the usual fantasies, you know, just like being raped.
Like, I'm in my kitchen, a guy breaks in, and at first I don't, and he's like, do you like it? She goes, not at first, but it's so horrible. I'm not going to play you that. I'm going to play you, this is his snippet of his fantasy. This is the example of the writing that you get. Thank you, Eric Steele, for reading it so well, but here you go.
She wanted to tell him why she was behaving this way. To explain that she didn't do this all the time. He probably thinks I'm a whore. Forget it. Don't get sappy or you'll ruin it. No, she said with a smile. It's your turn. Mine are usually orgies, he said. Or at least threesies. What are threesies? Three people. Me and two girls. Greedy. What do you do? It varies. Everything imaginable. Are you big? She said. Bigger every minute. What about you? Oh, I don't know. Compared to what? To other women. Some women have really tight ones. Ellen giggled. You sound like a comparison shopper. Just a conscientious consumer.
So all of the relationship stuff, whether it's all the relationship stuff, no matter who's the relationship stuff is involving, is so juvenile, and it just is gross and ham-handed. And speaking of which, this is perhaps the grossest book I've ever read.
Oh, right. That's right. The dolphins.
It's disgusting. And I forgot about this, too, the first time that I kept having to put the book down because I couldn't read the book if I was eating anything or having anything to drink because it is so gross. So there's gross just for the sake of being gross. Like we read, The Godfather, which has very grisly murders in it. Silence of the Lambs, Stand By Me, where there's like a dead body of a child that he describes in graphic detail, but it's all to serve the narrative.
Right.
This is just gross. There's the victim's body. There's the killing of the cat, like you described. It's just gross.
The sex scene is gross. The whole thing where they go out on the water, the three men go out on the water. And Quint, by the way, in the book, barely speaks. It's such an Ahab ripoff of Moby Dick. Like his whole
character. It really is.
It totally is. Yeah. And then Hooper and Brody hate each other. Like they hate each other right away. So they're on this boat and it's supposed to be like, ooh, there's all this tension. Like then you see the movie, you're like, no, they should be friends. It's so much better that they work together to solve the problem versus hating each other right off the bat. That makes no damn sense. And then on the boat, when they're trying to get the shark, they chop up baby dolphins and throw it in the water.
Oh my God. Yeah. And it goes on and on and on about they brought a baby dolphin to trap the shark with to as bait, right?
Right.
But it just the graphic, it is so gross. Like I kinda like barfed a little. It was so bad. And so we're going on and on about this book and how bad it is. So why on earth did they make it into a movie? Well, I will say this, the shark parts very compelling.
It's told from the shark's point of view. And that's kind of interesting.
So all of the bits about the shark are told, like you're saying, from the shark's POV, and they are actually very good because he's a shark nerd, Benchley is.
Yes.
And so he has all kinds of fun. It's actually interesting. It's actually really well written. And so from the shark bits, Spielberg was able to like somehow pull a whole movie together.
And so we should say, so it was actually bought when it was still being published. So what was happening is Richard Zanuck and David Brown are the producers. And David Brown was married to Helen Gurley Brown. And she was the editor-in-chief of Cosmopolitan Magazine. And I have a friend who does this for a living. She buys book properties for Universal. So Helen Gurley Brown recommended her husband, like, oh, my book editor thinks this is a really good property. You should check it out. So Zanuck was based in L.A. and Brown was based in New York. And they're both like basically doing that thing where they're, you know, this is before cell phones and fax machines or anything. Like they get on phone and talk about, you know, back and forth, like, hey, I heard about this. Let's make a deal for it. So they bought the rights for $175,000. And that's almost $1 million in today's dollars. So he was really psyched. And then that's when they decided to make the film. And Steven Spielberg was 26 years old at the time. He was super psyched to do it. He didn't like the human parts, but he knew he could fix it. And so that's where we go. And so after this, by the way, Peter Benchley wrote several more novels and screenplays, but actually over the years and towards the end of his life, and he passed away in 2006, I believe, he became a marine conservationist and really regretted making the great white seem like a predator. Like there's a whole thing in there about the shark being a rogue shark.
Oh, yeah, a rogue shark. Yeah, which is Total BS.
Yeah. That's bunk. It doesn't exist. And he felt bad about that. And that's at the clip at the top of the show. It's one of the, he's the first person to be on Shark Week when they do the Shark Week every year. And, you know, sharks are a part of the ecosystem, you know, mm-hmm. and you take them away and it changes everything. So he really, like I said, he really regretted that. He became a fan of sharks. He and his wife, Wendy, still swam with sharks. Like they weren't afraid of them. And so, and they did a lot of really great things and they have a website you can go visit and you can donate. So anyway, that was Peter Benchley. That was his book. And then it becomes the movie.
So yeah, amazingly, they were able to look at this book, which was such a mess, and go, wow, there's actually a really good movie in here somewhere. So Steven Spielberg, I don't know quite the story. I couldn't quite piece together the story of how they got the screenplay that they did.
So he worked with, first it went to Peter Benchley, took a pass at it. And it was not good. Mm-hmm. Then he did another pass at it, and it was not good. And then Steven Spielberg really worked with Carl Gottlieb to really shape the story. And then Peter Benchley was still a part of the process because obviously it's his property. And there's a great book out there called The Jaws Log, and they it's all the gossip about how this all came about is in there. If you're really you're a big Jaws fan, you need to get this book. It's called The Jaws Log. Excuse me. But Carl Gottlieb was the one who really helped shape the story.
And making the humans, you know, you can't just have it be about the shark. You can't have a movie from a shark's point of view, especially not in 1975. Brody and his wife, Ellen, in like a nice, loving relationship.
Right.
They're a team. They're these outsiders on the island, which makes it way more interesting. You know, you have more stakes in their relationship and in their future, you know, and they've got kids and they're sweet with their kids. Like they're horrible to the kids in the book.
Oh yeah.
It's so bad. Anyway, so they're an actual family and they're trying to like make a go in their fish out of water. And then the town politics is just the mayor who's got the interest of the town. His town's livelihood is at stake because of this shark, and so he's loath to close the beaches. The casting is amazing.
Yes, absolutely.
Can we just say?
Absolutely.
Wow. I love the cast of this movie. I was watching it again, and I was like, man, everybody is so great. And I can't believe Spielberg is just like a kid doing this movie. So many genius things that he did, not just from directing these complicated relationships and mature relationships for a 26-year-old, impressive, but also all the visual things. Like we talked, I remember about how the color scheme of the movie has almost no red, so that when you see the blood of the victims, it's shocking. And the, you know, the homes and the way the town is set up. I think they did Martha's Vineyard, yeah?
I believe it's or Nantucket. Let me double check that. But yeah, it was the first time they ever filmed there. And you really feel like you're a part of the island. And they filmed it in the spring of 74. And this is when the book was out. So they,
right.
But it was very cold. And you and I know this being on the East Coast, you know, the water is freezing that time of year. So they had to like pay people, I think they pay people like $60 to get into the water, which is a lot of money at the time. But they were like, you know, this is absolutely freezing. But yeah, it's a great set. I love their little house. I want to stay in that little house. I just think it's so cute.
It's so sweet with their little fence.
Yeah, and the swing. Yeah.
It's charming. And you really, again, you get invested not only in these people, but in this whole town. Like you really, you're not just like, close the damn beaches already. Like you're on the book. Like, what's wrong with you people? When you see it the way that Spielberg does it in the movie, you're like, oh my gosh, this town's really in trouble. If they can't be open, the beaches can't be open. Like they're all like, this whole little town is going to just shrivel up and die. So it's just so genius. You have the opening scene, which is the same as the opening scene in the book, where you have the first victim, Chrissy, who's swimming at night, kind of like a hippie chick, but it's so brilliantly done in the movie. It's done well in the book because, again, it's one of the shark scenes,
right?
But brilliant in the movie. It is really unlike anything ever seen on film. You're it's so scary that, and you know what's happening to her because you know the movie's called Jaws and you saw the poster on the way into the theater, but you don't ever see the shark.
You know what? They had a hard time building sharks. So this is, like we said, this is like 40 years ago. So the special effects are not that great. And if I've never seen a Jaws shark in person, excuse me. Some people have. They went on those studio tours.
Universal. Yeah.
Yeah, and they tell me it's terrible.
It's really bad. It looks really bad.
I hear it's so cheesy. And he built like three of them, and they were $250,000 each. But they built it in his backyard and on a studio lot. And so they tested it always in fresh water and pools. Well, as soon as it went into salt water, it sank. And so they had, so he had to always come up with these ideas. And the shoot went from like 55 days to 155 days because there were so much went wrong when they were filming this movie. Like they couldn't get any of the sharks to work. They didn't get the cast they wanted right away. They had to cast people at the last minute who turned out to be brilliant. But we have Robert Shaw as our Quint, Richard Dreyfus as Hooper. We have Roy Scheider as Brody, Lorraine Gary as Ellen Brody, who I just love, and Murray Hamilton.
I love her. Yes.
She's wonderful. And then Murray Hamilton as the mayor, who's just fantastic. And I forgot how great Hendricks was, the deputy that was a part of it.
I know. That's funny. I thought that too when I was watching. I was like, man, how did I not notice how good he is before? Yeah, he's super good. He's like he's sort of like the real life Barney Fife.
Yeah. Kind of. Yeah, totally a Barney Fife,
guy. He's never had to close a beach before.
Right. They had to build the signs.
The Murray, what's the guy who plays the mayor?
Murray Hamilton. I love him in The Graduate.
Yes, but this is a great performance that he has. You know, again, you really get invested in him. You totally see, okay, he's in many regards, he's a cheesy used car salesman. Like he's there to sell summer. But he's there because he knows that his town's livelihood depends on it. And at the very end, when the shark almost kills the chief's son, and he's says that his son was on the beach too, like you're just like, you really feel for the guy.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
As he slowly gets it. And yeah, and I love, is it Robert Shaw?
Yes, Robert Shaw. And here's the thing. So they wanted to get Sterling Hayden, who was also in The Godfather. He was the crooked cop. Charlton Heston wanted that part, and then he got turned down. He was bitter about that to the end of his life, that he lost that part.
Like him?
No. But then...
That Charlton Heston?
So they hired Robert Shaw, and he's a brilliant actor. And we talked about this last time, but it freaked me out when I do my research. He died in 1978. At the age of 51, he was 48 years old when he did this part. That old man in the movie is 48.
Yeah.
That's what heavy drinking does to you.
Wow. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know how old is he supposed to be if he fought in World War II.
He would have to be in like his 60s, wouldn't you think? It's the 70s, you minus the 30 years. He would be.
He'd be at least in his 50s. Yeah. Anyway, way older than he is.
Yes.
So, yeah, he was unfortunately actually a heavy drinker, but he's it's such a great performance.
Yeah, He and Richard Dreyfus didn't get along at the time. He thought that Richard Dreyfus was kind of a young punk. He's like 25, 26 years old, thought he knew everything. And Richard Dreyfus said he'd be a nice guy, but as soon as he had a drink in him, he could get really, really nasty and mean and like pick on him. And it's so funny that I found this YouTube clip recently, and Richard Dreyfus was on a talk show in Ireland, and the host said, "I want you to meet somebody. She's the granddaughter of Robert Shaw." And they bring her out. She's like 12 years old and she's cute as a button. And he started crying. And he said, I really admired his talent. It was so wonderful to be in that scene on the boat with him, and the crew really loved him. He was like very generous. And it was so sweet to watch. It's just like, it really humanized, you know, Robert Shaw and Richard Dreyfus for me. But there was a time on the boat, Robert Shaw, like we said, heavy, heavy drinker. And at one point he was mournfully saying to the cast and crew, like, "Oh God, I wish I could stop drinking." And Richard Dreyfus took his glass out of his hand and just threw it into the ocean. Like, 5 foot nothing, Richard Dreyfus, and he didn't take any crap.
But that scene, all at the scenes in on the boat, a lot of the end of the movie is similar to the end of the book, except they don't blow up the shark in the book.
Right.
In the book, those scenes, that ending section on the boat is just interminable. Because you hate everybody on the boat, and yeah, you're hoping, like, when is the shark going to come eat these people already? But in the movie, it's just so good. These three guys, and you're invested in all three of them in a different way. It's just, I could just watch it over and over and over again.
Absolutely.
It's so great.
Like,
it gets to three of them on the boat.
So it's a classic three-act structure, and Spielberg does that better than anybody. He sets things up, and then he mixes it up, and then you get to the action. And then the first section, they hired a lot of local actors from the area. So there was a woman named Lee Fierro, and she plays Mrs. Kintner. And Jeffrey Voorhees plays Alex Kintner. And this scene always, always gets to me. So Chrissy was killed.
So hard to watch.
Chrissy was killed on the beach. And then the coroner said, "Oh yeah, she was killed by a shark." And then he had to go back. I was like, "No, I think it was a motorboat. I don't think that was it." So Brody had to open the beach. And then poor Alex Kintner and a dog get eaten. And wait, and I can't, the poor woman having to like go out into the water, and everybody else, you know, got out of the water except her son. And it's heartbreaking. And
it is.
And you know, actually, the kid's name is Jeffrey Voorhees, I think I said. So 20 or 30 years later, after this movie was made, she went to a restaurant, and they had a sandwich called the Alex Kintner sandwich. And she was laughing. She goes, "Oh my God, is that a fish sandwich?" Like, yeah. She goes, "You know, I was the mother in that movie." And they said, "Hold on a second." And they go in the back and they bring it out. And the guy who played Alex Kintner, Jeffrey, came over to her and gave her a big hug. They had not seen each other since they made that movie. So they just totally reunited at this restaurant. Isn't that cute?
It's so cute. And she is magnificent.
She's wonderful. The scene where she slaps Brody. Scheider said, because she was an actress. She was a stage actress there, you know, in Massachusetts. She didn't have any film practice.
And so
she said, like, she really hit him across the face 17 times when she hits him.
Oh,
because she didn't know how to fake that. And then Roy Scheider, gentleman that he is, he kind of just took it because he understood she was new. But it was, but it was like over and over again, they had that scene. But she's powerful. And that whole thing, like, you remember the first time I watched it thinking, oh, she's being really hysterical. And then you watch it, you know, really watch it this time. Like, she's just being very matter of fact. Like, you know what? You told us that beach was safe, and now my son is dead.
Yeah.
And it's on your conscience now.
Yeah. It's great. And again, I mean, it's a great movie, hands down, of course. It's on all the lists. But if you manage to muscle through the book and then watch the movie, you are like, how on earth
did they screw this up?
Did they spin? Yeah. How did they spin such a beautiful movie out of such a piece of crap?
You know, like, what's crazy is that, so Alex dies. And, you know, this is tragic. He's like 9 years old, 10 years old. This kid died in the water. So the very next day, they're having a town meeting, and everyone's still just like, hey, come on, we got to stay open. You know, it's like there's no sort of, you know, thinking about, like,
by the way, two people have died.
Yeah, two people have died this week. But no, they're yeah. super into that. Oops, my microphone just moved. Anyway, so that's when we get our first introduction to Quint, and that's when we have like the fingernails on the chalkboard. I just love his performance in this.
I didn't agree to that. Only 24 hours. 24 hours is like 3 weeks. You all know me. Know how I earn a living. I'll catch this bird for you, but it ain't gonna be easy. It's bad fish. Not like going down the pond chasing bluegills or tommy cats. This shark, swallow you whole. Shaking, tenderizing, down you go. And we gotta do it quick. Now don't bring back the tourists, or they'll put all your businesses on a paying basis. But it's not going to be pleasant. I value my neck a lot more than $3,000, Chief. I'll fine him for $3,000, but I'll catch him and kill him for $10,000. And you got to make up your minds. You want to stay alive and ante up? You want to play it cheap? Be on welfare the whole winter. I don't want no volunteers. I don't want no mates. There's too many captains on this island. $10,000 for me by myself. For that, you get the head, the tail, the whole damn thing.
Thank you very much, Mr. Quint. We'll take it under advisement.
He's so good.
He's so good. And then Matt Hooper shows up, and like I said, Hooper, he works for the Oceanic Institute, and Brody calls him. And I love the fact, like, it's different from the book. In the movie, as soon as they meet each other, they're hugging. You know, they're like, oh, hey, yeah. Nice to meet you.
You're here, which is how you would be if you thought a shark was attacking your town. You'd be like, thank God the shark guy is here, as opposed to the book where he's like seething with resentment and doesn't want to call the shark guy for some reason. Yeah, it makes so much more sense. Of course you're happy to see him.
You need him. They need each other. He calls him. He needs him. I like the scene where they're also just having, so, you know, they get a shark. So the whole, and I love this, how the whole town goes crazy looking for a shark because it's for $3,000, and they're all going crazy. And then they bring a shark in, and it is gigantic. And by the way, the shark that they show in the movie for that scene is a real shark that they caught. But they caught it in Florida because they could not find sharks big enough. So they had to ship it to Massachusetts, and then it apparently stunk like anybody's business. Like the actors were really ready to vomit when they were doing that scene.
It said it on the trivia thing that like that because it was hanging upside down, like all its gross guts were like way up at the front of the shark. And so there's all these moments, because after I read that I'm watching the scene, and there's all these moments where people are not only standing right or next to this stinky thing, but like looking right in its mouth, like putting their decomposing shark. Ugh. Yeah. Ugh.
And then we have then the shark comes back again. You know, like they force them to do it. And here's my thing when I'm watching it, I'm like, okay, people can go to the beach. They just don't have to go into the water, but he makes them go into the water. The mayor's kind of pushing people to do it. And then we have our third killing, which is the guy on the boat trying to save the kids. And then, you know, this is when the town finally realizes, okay, we really need to get an expert. And that's when we get Quint. And that's, you know, so we have the beginning, we have our middle, and now we have our third act. And so the three heroes are going to go out on the water on the orca, the big boat orca, to get their shark. And it's thrilling. And the music, we forgot to mention, John Williams. Oh my goodness. Yeah. It adds everything.
Two little anachronisms that, again, only seeing the movie for the zillionth time, I was like, huh? Hooper says that the shark only feeds at night. And so they have this scene where they go out looking for the shark at night.
Yeah.
But the shark clearly does not only feed at night, because we've several times see the shark feed in the middle of the day.
Right.
And then later he's like, he's here for his noontime feeding. Like, dude, you just said he only eats at night.
Well, he also says to Brody, he's like, they're going out on the water. Like, they found the body of the guy's head. And that's still a great scare. You know, the Ben Gardner's head. But I keep saying, by the way, it's Martha's Vineyard, not Nantucket. It's Martha's Vineyard.
It is Martha's Vineyard.
Yeah, sorry about that. So anyway, so then he's like, takes him out. And where did this boat come from that he had all of a sudden? But he has a souped up boat with Loransky, by the way. And I know about marine gear, and that's like really good stuff, but like for the 70s. But anyway, he's like, Martin, don't worry about it. I'm just going to jump into the water right now. Like, didn't you say they feed it in the water? And you just saw a severed head, like a few, you know, miles away or whatever. Like, he's fearless. He's just like gonna jump right in there. But there was a killing that day, but he still was just sort of like, he didn't think it was like that big of a deal. And that's when you see the head. And then
he's like, I'll just go down there and check it out. Okay.
And that, so there were two big scares. So Steven Spielberg said he had two big scares. So one was Ben Gardner's head, and the other one was the first time you really see the shark. And he said that the first take he took at it, when he showed it to an audience, everyone freaked the hell out over the shark part. So he decided to go back and make the Ben Gardner's head scarier even than it was before, so we can get two great scares. But that's when he learned you really get just one big scare, and then after that everyone's on edge. And they filmed that,
right?
And they filmed it afterwards. Like, he wanted to make it scary, and the movie company said, no, we're not going to pay for that. So he did it in his own backyard in his pool, and they reshot that scene. So that whole great scare,
it's pretty scary.
Oh, it works. It totally works. It still makes me scream each time.
I know the head's going to be there. It always scares me. But the other thing that I was like, hold on. So the mayor's like all freaking out because nobody's going to come for summer. But because they have this shark, the place is like packed.
I know.
So do you have to force people to go into the water? Like, why can't you just rake in the shark bucks?
That's what I thought too. But this is like, I've watched this movie 100 times now. So that's been to my head. Like, why are you pushing people to go into the water if they're afraid to go in there? But they're still spending money. They're still staying at the motels.
Better they stay out of the water. They're hungrier. They're thirstier. They're hotter.
Yeah.
They need more stuff.
And maybe they'll see a shark fin, and that'll be exciting for them. Like, I don't. Yeah. I felt the same way. Stuff, yeah.
Shark burgers. Truck dogs, come on. This is not a creative mayor, but it's so good.
Yeah,
it is so good. The scene, I mean, we just go on and on. The scene where the kid's in the pond and the shark's coming. I mean,
terrified. That kid looks terrified.
So scary. It is so scary. My heart always pounds every time I see that. See, I just can't even deal. And then the little tiny kid who's crying.
That little face, that boy is so cute.
Get me. That little boy is so cute. So it's just a wonderful movie. It's a wonderful movie.
So they go out on the boat, on the Orca. So finally, and I love the third act so much. I just think Robert Shaw, the three of them are so brilliant. It's just the three of them out on water. And Steven Spielberg made sure they were really out on the water. Like, you couldn't see any land anywhere.
They're really out there, yeah.
And he says it's the most expensive handheld film ever. Because basically everything that last third is a handheld camera. Of him, just, you know, filming them. And they, of course, like we said, the shark wasn't working very well. So they did the best they could with the shots they had. But that's when someone came up with a brilliant idea. Like, well, why don't you just shoot him with these barrels? And the barrels will indicate how big and heavy this creature really is. And that works so much better.
It works great. Yeah. It's brilliant because your imagination just goes crazy. Like, oh my gosh, this thing must be so huge. And I forgot to mention, Peter Benchley, the author, has the cameo.
Yes, he plays a reporter on the water.
But he was apparently thrown off the set
because he hated the climax, which he has a point, but still, it's a movie. You got to make it. Well, let's talk about this one scene first. So my favorite scene for absolutely forever is Quint when he's talking about the USS Indianapolis. And he, like we said, he was a drinker. The first time he did it, he's like, well, they're all drunk, so I'll perform it drunk. And he was so embarrassed because it just wasn't good at all. And so the next day he said, he begged Steven Spielberg, please give me another chance. He came in stone cold sober. It's his own, like, he disagreed with the script, so he decided to do his own thing. And it's a little bit of a longer clip, you guys, but it's worth every minute. It's just that this is Robert Shaw, the USS Indianapolis.
Japanese submarine slammed two torpedoes into our side, Chief. He was coming back from the island of Tinian Delady. Just delivered the bomb, the Hiroshima bomb. 100 men went into the water. Vessel went down in 12 minutes. Didn't see the first shark for about half an hour. Tiger, 13-footer. You know that when you're in the water, Chief? You tell by looking from the dorsal to the tail. What we didn't know was our bomb mission had been so secret. No distress signal had been sent. They didn't even list as overdue for a week. Very first light, Chief. Sharks come cruising. So we formed ourselves into tight groups. You know, it's kind of like old squares in a battle, like you see in a calendar, like the Battle of Waterloo, and the idea was, shark comes the nearest man, that man, he start pounding and hollering and screaming. Sometimes the shark go away. Sometimes he wouldn't go away. Sometimes that shark, he looks right into you, right into your eyes. You know the thing about a shark, he's got lifeless eyes, black eyes, like a doll's eyes. When he comes at you, he doesn't seem to be living until he bites you. And those black eyes roll over white, and then... Oh, then you hear that terrible high-pitched screaming. The ocean turns red, and in spite of all the pounding and the hollering, they all come in and they rip you to pieces. You know, by the end of that first dawn, lost 100 men. I don't know how many sharks, maybe 1,000. I don't know how many men, they average 6 an hour. On Thursday morning, Chief, I bumped into a friend of mine, Herbie Robinson from Cleveland. Baseball player, bosun's mate. I thought he was asleep. Reached over to wake him up. Bobbed up and down in the water, it was like a kind of top. Upended. Well, he'd been bitten in half below the waist. Noon the fifth day, Mr. Hooper, Lockheed Ventura, saw us. He swung in low and he saw us to a young pilot, a lot younger than Mr. Hooper anyway. He saw us and he come in low, and 3 hours later, a big fat PBY comes down and start to pick us up. You know, that was the time I was most frightened, waiting for my turn. I'll never put on a life jacket again. So 1,100 men went in the war. 316 men come out. The sharks took the rest June the 29th, 1945. Anyway, we delivered the bomb.
That's just like my favorite scene.
It's so good, and it's so sad, you know, yeah. And it really, somehow that monologue just pulls everything together.
Yeah.
You know, not only are you feeling empathy for the three men on the boat, but you are also feeling empathy for the shark. It's, and then all of a sudden the shark comes knocking at the, it's just so good. It's such a beautifully written slash improvised scene. It is really good.
It's amazing. So in 2000 or 2001, I forget which one, but there was a young man named Hunter Scott. He was 11 years old and he saw the movie and he saw that scene and he said to his parents, like, is that a real thing? And they said, well, look it up, you know, like any good parent would, you know, make them do the research. This kid interviewed as many survivors as he could find. And 11 years old, he was able to clear the captain of that ship's name, because for all that time, until 2001, they said he was guilty of this, that it was a shame on him. It was his fault that the accident happened. And by the way, his congressman at the time was Joe Scarborough. And Joe Scarborough, you know, Morning Joe on MSNBC, he had this kid go to Congress and be able to present this. And like I said, the man's name was cleared. And Margo, his name is Hunter Scott. I put a link in the show notes for his book that he wrote when he was 11 or 12. But he is now a naval aviator based in San Diego.
Oh, wow.
Where you are.
Well, I am right now. We have a lot of those here.
Yeah, I'm sure you
naval
do.
Naval aviators. Yeah, we do. You know, Top Gun and all that. Wow. Yeah, it's that's such an amazing story. And that's because of the movie. That's because somebody thought, like, no, you know what? Quint needs some
backstory.
Pathos. Yeah. And so, yeah, it ended. There was some disagreement from Benchley, the author, and the movie producers about the end of the movie with the exploding shark. But it's got to end somehow.
Yeah, and in
you got to end it. You got to get off that boat. You got to get back on the land.
We got
with the shark gone.
We need something thrilling too. We need heroes. Yeah. We need them to be heroes. And so, what happened in the book is that Hooper is eaten by the shark. By the way,
right?
And that was going to happen in the movie as well. So, what happened in pre-production is Spielberg sent a crew to Australia, and they actually got in these cages and filmed great white sharks. And there was one in particular that was not happy about this, and like the shark really beat the crap out of the cage, and the person that was in the cage was able to get out and film everything, and he never went back in that cage again. But they had this footage, and then they decided in the end just to like have Hooper live. Like, so Richard Dreyfus kind of like goes away, but in the book he's eaten by a shark. And then in the book, Quint, like, he goes like we said in Moby Dick, like his leg gets caught in rope and pulled out to the water, which is
it's such a ripoff.
It's such a ripoff of Moby Dick. It's really, really bad. Yeah. And so in the book, the shark kind of just dies, right? It's injured, and it's which is not fun.
Yeah. It's not that satisfying.
No,
really, no, not like blowing the thing up.
And then says, "Smile, you son of a bitch," and he.
Come on. It's a movie.
It's a movie. And you need something. And I'm sure in the movie theater at the time, people freaked the hell out when that happened. Because it still makes me want to clap and sing and like, yay, Roy Scheider. Yeah. Roy Scheider is so good in this movie.
He really is.
He's really wonderful.
You get his fear of the water and the wrestling with the fear of the water versus the concern for the people and overcoming that. And you know, all again, fish out of water, being a New York guy in this on this island, and it's a lot of layers that he brings to the performance.
Slower, Hedge. I can go slower, Hedge. Come on down and chum some of this shit.
He's wonderful. And then so he and so Richard Dreyfus comes up and they paddle to shore. And that's the movie. And at the time, they released it in 450 theaters, and it was a huge box office success. And as I said, I talked about it with my mother and and she's like, everybody was talking about it everywhere you went. So it was like an event, you know, my mom with her four kids, like my mom and dad, like got a babysitter, like we got to go to this thing. And it changed movies forever. You know, now we have a summer blockbuster schedule. It was the number one movie at the time for exactly 2 years. And then Star Wars came along.
Right. Yeah. I mean, it was a real phenomenon. It was just everywhere.
When it was initially released, they say over 67 million Americans went to see the movie in the movie theater that summer. And at the time, there's like 250 million people. So think about that. That's like one in every four people. Or I don't know. I can't do math. But that's a big percentage of people.
Yeah.
And there was a great song. There's and we'll play it at the very, very end of the show. But Dickie Goodman had a song called Mr. Jaws. And he just interspersed different records. It's a novelty song. But you know, that's how big Jaws was. Like, Jaws was everywhere. They had it on Saturday Night Live. Remember that? They had the shark sketch.
Yeah, the land shark. But Mr. Jaws, and we should say Mr. Jaws. You listen to Mr. Jaws. Most of you will not probably be old enough to remember Mr. Jaws.
No.
But you could be like, okay, this is bananas. Like, what is this? Mr. Jaws got played on the radio, like, all day long.
It's all the time.
The time. So that's what we did before cable and internet and YouTube and things of that nature. So again, you know, when people say to us, like, isn't the book always better than the movie? We always say, you're someone who hasn't read Jaws. Have you read Jaws? I bet you haven't. Because, yeah, I think, hands down, this is the worst book that produced the best movie.
I think you're right.
Yes?
I totally agree with you, Margo. Yeah. Out of the ashes came something wonderful.
Yeah. We've had a lot of book and movies where the books, this is not the only one, by the way, where the book was not so fabulous and it made a great movie. Mr. Spielberg seems to be very good at that, Jurassic
yes.
Park. But this is like the silk purse out of the sow's ear of books and movies. It is quite a feat on the part of young Mr. Spielberg and everybody else involved in this classic movie. So no contest, movie.
Movie.
There you have it.
Movie.
Don't read the book and certainly please don't get the Audible. Or if you do, you could just do that thing where you return it right away. Just
yes.
like, please take it back Audible and get something else.
Yes.
But if you are at your public library and you happen to spot a first edition on the shelf, just pull it out and look at the cover and put it right back.
And we'll have it on our Facebook page, or you could Google it. But yeah, it's a pretty goofy picture.
That's right. So thanks a lot, everybody, for listening. And we'll be back with The Graduate.
Let a Simon and Garfunkel coming up.
Yeah.
Okay, now speaking of Simon and Garfunkel, someone very close to their talent, ladies and gentlemen, Dickie Goodman.
Enjoy.
Captain, will you be able to catch this giant shark?
I will.
Thank you, Captain. Captain, when you catch one of these sharks, what do you feel like?
Like a rhinestone cowboy.
We've just sighted.
Thank you so much for listening to the Book vs. Movie podcast. We're a part of the Frolic Podcast Network. You could find more podcasts you will love at frolic.media/podcasts. You could find us on Twitter, Threads, Blue Sky, and Instagram at Book vs. a Movie. Just spelled it all out. We have a Patreon page. Type in their Book vs. Movie podcast, where you can find 8 years worth of shows. You can follow Margo D on social media at Brooklyn Margo and also Brooklyn Fit Chick. You can find Margo P at She's Nacho Mama. Thank you again for listening, and please be sure to send along your suggestions for the show. Remember, the book needs to be easy to get your hands on, and the movie has to be streaming on a major platform. We'll be back soon with